from that engaging topic with Val about health and sleeping hygiene, we dive into youth and politics this morning. My name is Karanja Alex. You're right on time for Youth and Politics. And this morning we'll be looking at several topics, among them the skyrocketing wage bill that has hit the country. And of course, Kenya's debt and its impact to us as the citizens. And to help us demystify the mystery behind all these things, I'm joined by two guests. And one among them is Muthiora Kariara, who is a former deputy presidential candidate.
Thank you very much for having me yet again. Sana. I see you really care about the young people of this nation.
Definitely.
And that's why every time you have a chance, you get us to come and talk about it.
You are most welcome, always. And of course, next to him is none other than Kaberia Barrio, who is a political analyst.
Thank you so much, and welcome to the show.
Yes, and I want us to begin with what transpired yesterday in Gishoro constituency in Murang'a County, where the Tanga Tanga team and Kieleweke team and apparently staged all over, like, they were up for fundraising, which apparently ended up chaotic.
Well, I'll say Kenya has lacked political hygiene for a very long time.
All right.
And yesterday was just a manifestation of this sustained problem. We have a group that has gone purportedly to bring development to a constituency. When you're the member of parliament, you don't go just stamping. Mm-hmm. What you need to do, if you don't agree with what they're doing, is have a parallel event, call your own people, do a fundraiser. In that case, that constituency will have two fundraisings. So development will come faster. So I would like to call out this young leader, mm-hmm. to ask him to behave with decorum when it comes to public affairs, because yesterday that was totally uncalled for, causing commotion in church with senior members. Mm-hmm. That's the worst it can get. So Team Tanga Tanga, Team Kieleweke, it doesn't matter if at the end of the day, Mwananchi is going to get served.
So all right.
Let's not buy into these shenanigans. Mm-hmm. They were looking to cause drama. They caused drama. Now they have attention. We are talking about them. This is not how to do things.
Right. Kaberia, as we get your insight on this topic that transpired yesterday, do you think we are fighting, or rather we have a supremacy battle between Kieleweke and Tanga Tanga?
Yes, definitely there is a big supremacy battle, and this is something which has been in play for a long time. And it's just like yesterday, one of the incidents which came up, and it was a clear manifestation of the battle which has been there. Looking even at the various addresses which has been there from the president and even the deputy president on let's stop the issue of politics, especially from the president, and focus on delivering first before even talking about the 2022. Mm-hmm. And we have seen a very clear division between the members of parliament allied to different sides, and each one of them tried to call others names basing on this one after money, this one is after this and that. But not looking at even the yesterday's incidents, what happened in Kiharu, I think, where Didinyoro and Maina commander clashed, we can see a lot of political unhygieness, as he has really put it, very right. clear. And this is something which is very unfortunate, bearing in mind even the place where they were, it's even in a church. And this shows how even the church has been so much misused to be even the podium whereby the politicians are settling the scores. And right. we have seen this not only in Kiharu, it's also happened in Vika at some time, yes. whereby we had clashes of members of parliament aligned on those different missions. So this is not just a responsibility of even the politicians only, but also the church elders and the leaders. This right. is the real time they stamp on the authority and be able to control mm-hmm. the political atmosphere by who they give the mic and stand on the podium on the basis
is
of
the
politics.
Is the church justified to bring in politicians rather than the church or rather give them the microphones during church services?
In fact, if I am, I fellowship with the Catholic Church.
Right.
If I'm the bishop or the cardinal in this regard, I would be very strict on this. Sometime we had the Archbishop of Anglican Church who really stood and said that we don't want to have the politicians misusing the podium,
right.
but people did not buy that well. But what we need, it's not to say that politicians should not be given the microphone, but we need to have a very good moderation on how and even when to do that.
Right.
If they have come for fundraising, if they have come to fellowship, let them come just as the way the normal members are, and let them not take much of the airtime of the church. There is that thing after the service, and let it be clear that this is not a political podium. If you are to give us contribution of that, well and good, don't play politics with it. If it is tithe, there's a very even clear structure even in the Bible now, people shouldn't tithe.
Right.
You should not create a short of that, which would definitely create a lot of tension.
I wouldn't want us to dwell so much on the church aspect, but I want us to dwell on the part of the Jubilee Party. And I'd like probably you can, Muthiora can use this microphone. This one is breaking a little bit. Muthiora, I see that you have some point that you'd like to air. And this is my question. Both Kieleweke and Tanga Tanga, of course, are all of them from Jubilee regime. Do you think that Jubilee is heading for a downfall?
Well, we know that Jubilee was formed to win the 2017 election. It did that.
So not for
it
FISA?
Served its purpose. That's the fate of all political parties in Kenya.
Right.
They are formed just to win elections. So to expect that Jubilee is going to offer leadership to this nation, it's like expecting to get water out of a stone. It's not going to happen. Jubilee served its purpose. We have this government running. It's not going to be there going forward. In 2022, Jubilee will not be what we see it today.
Right. So for you, Jubilee is headed for a downfall?
It's not headed for a downfall. Jubilee is down as we speak.
All right.
You can see the kind of debate we've had in Parliament where we couldn't even agree on revenue allocation. And yet, Jubilee has majority in both Senate and Parliament. And yet, they could not agree to move the nation forward. One house had to pull back. If Jubilee was not down, that would not have happened.
All right. I'm prompted to ask this question. Ruto has, at several occasions, said that he's going to vie for presidency. And you said that Jubilee is on a downfall. Where do you think Ruto will stand in terms of the political party he'll go with?
Well, my thought is, before 2022, we will see new alliances being formed.
Right.
We will see new parties. There will be new players. The deputy president will not have the Jubilee Party as we know it,
right,
heading into 2022. That I can guarantee you. We have the BBI coming up and he's not sitting pretty.
Mm-hmm.
We have all these other noise. That's not going to give him a chance to have the Jubilee ticket as Uhuru Kenyatta had it in 2017.
I didn't want us to dwell so much on, because I know we can talk about the Building Bridges initiative that you've just mentioned, but I want us to dive to the main topic of the day, of course, I know, shifting gears all the way to now, the current wage bill. And some of the reports that I have here are quite shocking, because when we look at Kenya currently, its wage bill rose from 5 billion from the 2013-2014, of course, financial year, and currently we're standing at 7 plus US dollar billion wage bill. Where do you think we are headed when we're looking at this? Because already statistics says that more alarming fact is that the gross domestic product ratio stands at 8.2%, which is high above the global recommended rate by 0.79. Already we are far much higher above by 0.79 rather.
We should be worried as a nation, because if we were able to run Kenya back then with the kind of debt to GDP ratio that we had. You remember when Kibaki was leaving office,
yes,
we were doing less than 2 trillion.
Sure. Actually,
but
it was
right
one
now,
point something.
Mm-hmm. In just 7 years, it has risen to almost
it
6
was 1.
trillion.
It was 1.7 trillion.
1.7
yes.
trillion. Now, if in 7 years, if since independence,
mm-hmm,
we only got to 1.7 trillion,
mm-hmm,
but in 7 years, we've risen to almost 6 trillion. What does that tell you? That tells you that the kind of leadership we have today is one that's not worried or does not care about our future. So as Kenyans, we should be worried. We should look to correct course, because things are not rosy at all. You've had people cry that the economy is tough, and indeed it's tough. It's only good for a few lucky people, and then those others who are corrupt and well-connected. But for the majority,
mm-hmm,
the economy is hitting them hard. numbers do not lie.
Right.
And just like you have mentioned, there is the recommended percentage of debt to GDP, debt to revenue, which should never go beyond 35%. Mm-hmm. For Kenya, it's over 55% right now. Mm-hmm. All the revenue that we are collecting through our taxes is going into paying wages and salaries and repaying debt. When are we going to develop our nation if we keep on these?
All right, Kabere, I want you to respond, or rather give your reactions on these. The government has stated that from now henceforth, or rather from this year, they'll be giving out 3-year contract to any person that probably is by any chance given a governmental office. My question is, will we manage, will we solve the issue of the wage bill despite even the 3-year contract term?
Well, I think it's the wage bill in Kenya, it's really ballooning and it's a serious crisis. And I think what the government was trying to do through the Public Service Board is to bring in a short-term measures, at least to be able to curb that, as even they are trying to think of the long-term. But what I'm trying to say is that this is not the way to go if you want to think of really managing the wage bill, because this, you are thinking of those people already entering the public sector, and right now we are having 800,000, an estimate of 800,000, public servants. So if you just say that anyone who will be employed will be on a 3-year contract, it means that those who are already in employment, you have not been able to put a measure even to be able to control that. So I think the country, this is the high time, even the leadership should be more futuristic and should even be now looking at various ways on how to be able to manage this. Because it's very unfortunate when we have huge chunk of the budget going on the recurrent budget that is being meant of salaries. Mm-hmm. And there's no economy which has ever been developed by the recurrent budget. It's actually the development budget which should be higher. So I think the government, it's the high time they just think of even be able to manage the wage bill by even trying to enhance and strengthen the Salaries and Remuneration Commission, excuse me, which has come up with so many measures but which are not being implemented because of even the lack of goodwill. We have heard of duplication of various positions in government.
You mentioned about lack of goodwill.
Yes.
So what, who would you directly say that probably this is the person, or rather this is the particular institution that has failed?
Definitely, it's the executive from the presidency. And looking at the various aspects which play when it comes even to the SRC, because we have heard of situation whereby their recommendation are even not really taken into account.
Right.
So when we talk of goodwill, it means it should come from the top institution, from the presidency trickling down. And this will also be a good example to the governors, because we've also seen a tussle between the governors and even the SRC trying to say that we have some autonomy to protect, and so we can be able to increase salary, employ more people as we want. So I think there should be a lot of goodwill. And also, again, looking at that, the duplication of positions in government. We've seen so many positions and so many, like, talk of even the nominated and the number of MCAs we have in the country. A very big number, consuming almost 2 billion of the budget. Is this something that we really need? So those are the questions, the provocative questions we should be now having as an issue.
Probably coming to you, Muthiora, the issue, he has mentioned about the issue of duplications, and this has affected, it usually emerges when we are talking about the wage bill and the debt that currently Kenya has. Let's have a look at it from this way. Can merging of public entities and even the duplication try to, can these really solve the issue of the wage bill?
It can, and it will, if we do it right, because what you do is, you pay two people to do the same job. Obviously, that does not make sense. So to get out of our situation, first, we need to eliminate redundancy and duplication of roles. That's getting it right. But then that's not even the problem. The problem with Kenya is, number one, currently, as things are, we lack vision. It's not clear what this government wants to achieve. We know that the biggest problem for this nation right now is poverty. That's fueled by unemployment. Now, when the top leadership, in their wisdom, decides to create positions such as the CAS, it's not a 3-year term job they created, and they did this across all ministries.
Yes.
Some, they even provided 2. And then you come and say, when we are hiring, and when they are hiring young people, it's you and me. they say they will give you a 3-year contract. Is this a government that's serious on fixing what the problem really is?
Right.
They're just playing games and rewarding their cronies. This is not the way to go, and we should see whatever effort they make to hoodwink us and call it as such.
All right. I was trying to look at some of the countries that I've tried to merge and some deal with the issue of the ghost workers, and one among them is Tanzania and Uganda, so just our border countries. And Tanzania workers reduced the wage bill to 2.47.2 million, that is US dollars, last year, that is in 2018, all the way from 248.
The question is not about reduction. We should be asking ourselves, are we getting value?
All right.
First and foremost. Mm-hmm. The truth is we are not. So what can we do to increase productivity?
Of the country, of the persons?
Of the persons already employed. If you go to a government office, you can be sure that, number one, they don't even put in the time they are supposed to put in. And then even when they are at work, they were not competently hired. So you find there is a skill mismatch. People are not able to execute their roles because then the wrong field, then the wrong posting, you know, the nepotism, tribalism that comes into play when you're hiring. So the question we should be looking to answer is, do we have the right people in the right jobs so that they can create value? Because the government does not create employment for the nation. What they do is they create an enabling environment. Are the people who have been hired through our taxes helping to create that environment? It's okay if the wage bill balloons, mm-hmm. but then the GDP is also growing commensurate to whatever we are putting in to pay these civil servants.
All right, Kabiria, do you think we're going anywhere in terms of growth with the current wage bill?
Well, when you talk about the growth of a nation, there are various aspects, even on the economic perspective, yes. that you really look at. As one we has mentioned, is about now the GDP. Mm-hmm. Then the other thing is now the production. When you look at this country, Kenya, we import more than we even export. And the level of industrialization, actually, when you look, it has reduced from 12.4% to 8%, meaning that most of the industries and the production have declined in the recent past. Looking at even the industries which have collapsed, the companies which are even closing down and even moving to our neighboring Ethiopia and other countries. So when you want to look at the growth, sometimes it's good to ignore the economic statistics that we are even given, that we see growth by 4% or by 5%, right. but look at even the reality of even aspect of the common Mwananchi. Are we seeing some changes or some even growth even as Mwananchi ourselves? When you talk about that, we look at even at the hospitals, the infrastructure and all that. So I think in Kenya, when we talk about growth, we can't see significant growth as maybe we expected. And there's a lot of things which are going wrong, and there's a lot of even stagnation on some sectors. So it's the high time that we really look at what are the things which we need to put in order in terms of the policies and also the leadership, because the growth comes from good leadership.
Right.
And when we get the issue of leadership right, then the other things won't have a problem in fixing them.
When you mentioned that, I want us now to look at Kenya's debt and its impact towards our citizens. Mm-hmm. And did you know that you owe the government of Kenya exceeding 100,000 shillings? That is just an individual. More to it, do you know that the country incurred 975.8 billion shillings loan in the 2018-2019 financial year? Well, how do we get to all this? President Uhuru Kenyatta inherited a public debt of 1.7 trillion shillings in 2013 from the previous regime of President Mwai Kibaki. And from then, we have seen several loans borrowed from different countries in seek to achieve what the government says is its goals, which apparently have changed over the past few years with the ones that we had from laptops all the way come now to the four goals that the government has. And Central Bank of Kenya showed that the country's public debt expanded by 15.2%, which is 0.851 trillion shillings, to hit the 5.89 trillion. We are headed to 6 trillion public debt. I wanted to look at some of the slides. I don't know whether the slide is ready. According to the Institute of Economic Affairs, the report says that China stands at we owe China 637 billion shillings, which is 70.6%. Second in the rank is Japan with 104.7 billion shillings, which is 11.7%. And then third we have France, which stands at 62.2 billion shillings, which of it is 7%. All the way going to Germany, we stand at 35 billion shillings, which is 3.9% rather. Italy, which is the fifth one in the rank, it's 15.6 billion shillings, which is 1.7%. I don't want to look as deeper into the rest of the countries. I want to take your reactions on this.
Well, number one, I'll tell you, we have mismanaged our economy, because how on earth do you accumulate such a huge debt from one country? You've seen what the percentage is with China. Mm-hmm. That means our leadership was not looking forward. You need to diversify. That's something we've not done. Mm-hmm. Look at that. It says we have borrowed our debt portfolio.
Yes.
We owe 70.6% to China. So if things today did not go right and we messed up our relationship with China and they said, you have to pay us today, we fold up as a nation. Now, this is something we should not do. I'm glad the economic hitman we had in the CS of Henry Rotich.
Right. Them buttoned.
Yeah, he's on his way to committee, because this is one person who has done this nation a great disservice. While he was a CS, our debt moved from 1.7 all the way to 6 trillion. It's actually over 6 trillion. This is a government that's not very keen even to give you the right figures.
According to the government, it says 5.89.
Yes. The same government that says that the unemployment amongst the youth is less than 20%. So these figures, when they're given to you, you have to take them with a pinch of salt. Mm-hmm. Now, obviously, when all your revenue goes into recurrent expenditure, that's debt payment, mm-hmm. wages, you're not sitting pretty.
Right.
We need to correct the course that this nation is going on to. And unfortunately, unless we start to make a lot of noise, and this I'm urging all Kenyans out there, and especially the young people who can make sense of what these numbers are,
yes.
they will not take corrective action and will keep sinking deeper into this morass. And Kenya will never be great.
All right. I want Barry, before we even take your insight on these, or rather your take on these figures. I have a question about UK has been a long time business partner since independence with the country, and apparently it's not in the list, or rather on the list. Yeah. What's your take on that?
Well, this is a very serious issue, because UK has been our strong partner from even the colonial era, being they were in our colonial masters. Mm-hmm. But it's very unfortunate that maybe due to some political reasons, because we can't see them in the list. And I'm saying political reasons because these people, they have supported us in so many ways, from right. even funding most of the projects, even giving the grants. But now when it comes to borrowing, I remember there's a time Theresa May was here with a delegation from the place, and those are some of the issues they were trying to explore. And I remember very clearly that the president was saying that we are trying to build the relationship, even the business relationship with the UK. So I really don't know what exactly made the relationship go bad, but I know it's all about the political interest
right.
and who is able even to oil the hands of these politicians well. Knowing that China, they have a very crafty way of doing their own things, and you see even the delegation, they encountered all the presidents of Africa with very good incentives and all that. So that's something which we really need to be very careful on even the incentives which they are giving for us to take the loans, because these are loans and not the grants, so they are making some good money out of that.
All right, and I want to take your views on this particular issue, because when you mention about debt, it has to come along with collaterals.
Yeah.
Apparently, the government has not become clear of what has been given out. Those, it's alleged that among them is JKIA, of which it's an allegation as it stands. But the government keeps on saying that they'll air out, they'll give to the public some of the quarters they've given.
In December, the president said he was going to disclose
yes.
all the details about the SGR mm-hmm. when he was speaking at State House in Mombasa. To date, he has yet to give those details.
9 months down the line.
Yes, which means there are some things that are not very nice that have been hidden in the fine print of the contracts we've entered into with China. So talking about collateral, again, like I said, as Kenyans, we should be very, very worried about how our government is doing business. You've mentioned JKIA. It's possible that some of our national assets could have been put as collateral. Unfortunately, we do not know the finer details of the contracts we've entered into or these leaders have entered into. So what I need for us to do is to remain vigilant. We need to keep asking these questions. When these leaders come to church, to politics, we should tell them to sit down. We should tell them to tell us what exactly it is they do with the mandate that we gave them, because we did not elect them to talk to us. We elected them to represent us. And when they are not giving information about what contracts they are getting into on our behalf, they are failing. And we should tell them when they are failing and demand from them that they give us this information. Our parliament has been quiet for a very long time. So we need to ask our members of parliament to go back to the August House and do duty for this nation.
All right. Before I even talk to Baru, let me ask you. You have seen several presidents coming to Kenya, of which bilateral trade agreement have been signed.
Yes, and some
we have given even land to other countries.
Exactly. That's what I wanted to mention. When they come here, they're not necessarily coming here for our own goods. Mm-hmm. They are coming here for their selfish interests. I know about Kenyan government officials who have been given land in the DRC. We know that our president has dished out land.
As a country, standing out for the country.
Well, of course, they go there under the disguise that they are representing the people of Kenya.
Right.
But then whatever gains that accrue from such deals are personal. They are for themselves, their cronies, and their families. Our president has given land to South Sudan.
Definitely.
To Uganda. Of course, these are our business partners, but then are these beneficial to us? We should not just accept things because we feel like we are in a helpless situation. No, we're not in a helpless situation. What we need to do is to petition our leaders, and especially those in parliament, that yes, we've done 2 years the way that we've done them. Yes, there's the handshake and everything that's going on, but then they must remember that they are there because they are supposed to oversight this government. They are supposed to represent us. They are supposed to be taking care of the interests of the Kenyan people. Let them canvass these matters in the floor of the house and hold this government to account.
Beru, do you think we are as a country we are struggling in terms of leadership, in terms of even impact that is felt from the leaders?
Yes, definitely. We are really struggling in terms of leadership because when we talk about leadership, it is on the value and the impact which they are able to create to the people who put them in power. And looking at even the various leadership we have, especially on the political leadership, we have not really been able to get the real value in terms of even the economic development, also the social services, and even on the political space.
Right.
And this is something which we can be able to see it even at the common grassroots level, go even to the common mwananchi. Everyone, they are really complaining that the economy is unbearable. Sometimes you go even to the public utilities and you don't find the services which you should be getting. Go even to the hospitals. We have so many hospitals without drugs. We have schools without enough teachers. And we've seen even the drought crisis in Kenya at this age of time whereby we have a government in place, people dying of hunger. All this is not because of the issue of climate as we talk about. This is an issue of leadership, because with the proper leadership, you are able to put up proper team, you are able to put up even proper policies which are able to mitigate all these factors. And I think this is a problem which we should look at as Kenyans, on even who are the people which we entrust with the leadership positions. Is it basing on the financial muscles? Is it basing even on the way we know them, the family, the dynasties and all that? It's the high time we will look at the marking scheme we are having to be able to elect the leaders that we put in office.
I don't want to talk so much about disaster management, which has been a menace for the past few years in the country in terms of drought-stricken areas, some of the counties in the country. But I want us to stick to the topic of the day, and I'm looking at the country as per it stands. Do you think we have the ability and the capability to pay the monies as per it is by 2030, when we are supposed to have fulfilled our vision 2030?
Well, Kenya is a very wealthy nation. Alex, if you may recall, we recently exported crude.
Yes.
We have a lot of other minerals that are yet to be explored and harnessed so as they can benefit this nation. He just gave you the numbers about our manufacturing dwindling. How can our manufacturing be doing so badly when we have such a big number of people who are unemployed? We just don't have our priorities right. Kenyans have been paying taxes. If you look at the KRA records, there is not a single year when the numbers have not gone up, which means we have the potential. We've been building capacity,
right.
But unfortunately, we've been destroying value through this thing we call corruption. This thievery, the stealing, the looting of public resources is what's hurting this nation. So the Vision 2030 blueprint, it can still be actualized. We've gone slower than we could have because we concentrated on things we should never have focused on. The short-term goals, some leaders want to show that, yes, we are delivering, but in the long run, we can still meet a lot of the targets that we had set for ourselves in the Vision 2030 blueprint.
Do you think the Jubilee government will manage to probably fulfill their four goals?
Not at all. If a simple goal such as the one they said about delivering stadiums,
right.
They have not delivered even a single stadium 7 years since they made that promise.
Right.
How do you expect they are going to provide housing for over 50 million Kenyans?
Mm-hmm.
How do you expect that the dream of universal healthcare is going to come through? But we must keep exerting pressure on them because manufacturing needs to work. Young people need jobs. We need to come out of poverty. Kenyans are ready to work. And the environment, looking at our level of education, our enthusiasm, passion. Investors are ready to come as long as the government is willing to provide the right kind of an environment.
All right. Many thanks, gentlemen, for making it here. But before we wind up, I want to give each and every one of you some few seconds to just give your parting shot.
Well, thank you so much. And my parting shot will be so specific to the viewers because I believe that each and every person has a responsibility when it comes to the direction the country will take. And now as the time we're even contemplating on even the next elections, this is the high time we now change our thoughts and on terms of leadership,
right.
So that we are able to give an opportunity to even young leaders with vision, with even not even looking necessarily as where they come from. So it's the high time as the young people and even as the Kenyan people that we put into leadership, people with vision and also people with the love and kindness for the humanity, as opposed even to people with the monies and all that. And that's how we'll be able to change most of the things which are affecting this country.
Right.
Well, I would like to appeal to all Kenyans and especially the young people that we've gotten to a stretch where we must stay woke.
Right.
You saw yesterday what happened in Muranga. It doesn't matter that it's a church. Politicians are going to outdo each other just to capture the limelight.
Right.
Let us be vigilant. Let us remember that it's not too late. We can recall these leaders. That clouds has been activated. We're within that threshold. Let us get value for our money.
Right.
There is no taxation without representation. Let us demand the very best from our leaders.
Wow. Gentlemen, many thanks for making it here. And we much appreciate as well to Faithful Team. We look forward, of course, to have some other engagement some other day. Many thanks. That has been Youth and Politics, you know, looking at some of the things and some of the statistics that we have in the country relating to the wage bill and, of course, the public debt. That is every day skyrocketing and affecting some of the things that we look at in terms of infrastructure and everything that relates to the economy. My name is Karanja Alex. Many thanks for keeping it here. Val is coming up next. Don't miss out. This is Y254. Many thanks.